I'm going to talk a little bit about real thing about quantum mechanics, and more specifically, real things that quantum mechanics can do to better our lives. So I'm not pretending that I'm going to teach you everything about quantum mechanics and quantum computing and quantum information, but I'm going to teach a little bit. But I want to jump straight to what we know can be done with that and what some of the researchers here at IQC and around the world are trying to achieve today and for the future. So let's put just level the playing field a little bit. So what is quantum mechanics? So quantum mechanics is a theory that explains how atoms and molecules behave. Because turns out when you start going at the very small, the world is not what it seems. It's rather different. it's a theory that was devised in the 1930s, 1920s, because the science that we knew at the time completely failed at explaining some of the experiments we're running in the lab. And here what I mean completely failed, I don't mean like it was a little bit off, right? We're talking something like it was way, way off. Let me give you just a quick example. When we were trying to understand how atoms behave, so atoms has been speculated about since Democritus, like since 2,000 years ago. And it was just an idea trying to answer the question, what is stuff made of? So people started thinking, oh, maybe it's all a little bunch of little particles that get together. And then as science and technology advanced, we started having an idea, more and more observation that was things like, yeah, actually everything is made up of particles. And then we started having different theory. We had different theory about how the atoms look like. And again, as the technology advanced, we had more and more precise measurement, and we started having some pretty good ideas that actually an atom is mainly empty and is made of two different types of particles, something that is positively charged and something that is electrically charged. And then all the positive stuff is, you know, concentrated in the middle, and then all the negative stuff kind of are little particles that hangs around. And then we kept on asking questions, okay, how do they hang around? Why, they cannot just be sitting still, because we knew if you have something positive and something negative that sits still, they attract each other, and at some point they will collide. So the physics at the time was saying that, well, it should actually rotate around the center, just like Earth rotate around the sun. But the problem with this is that also the science at the time was saying, like, if I have a electrically charged particle that goes around in the circle, it must radiate light. So that was the theory, that was what the Maxwell's equation was telling us, a theory of light and the electric field and magnetic field. And if it radiates light, then your electrons must be losing energy. So if they lose energy, they must be getting closer and closer and closer and closer, and ultimately, they would need to collide with the nuclei, with the nucleus. So the science at the time, at the turn of the 20th century, was saying atoms cannot be stable. They must ultimately fall on themselves. And if you do a quick back of the envelope calculation, science was telling us that atoms should essentially collide on themselves in a fraction of a nanosecond. How old is the universe again? Well, we've been here for half an hour, so it's at least older than half an hour. But science was saying that the universe should have collided on itself in a fraction of a nanosecond. So when I'm saying that science was completely wrong, that's an example of how wrong it was. It was not off by 2% or 3%. It was off by billions of years. So this is why it needed a completely new approach. And that completely new approach was quantum mechanics. Radically new mathematical approach to trying to explain atoms and molecules. And to this day, quantum mechanics is the most precise theory ever devised by mankind. Every attempt at proving it wrong failed. And there's still no experiment today that cannot be explained by quantum mechanics. But there's one catch, is that quantum mechanics is completely insane. And what I mean by this is I mean that there's nothing in our everyday life that prepares us to fully grasp the prediction of quantum mechanics. It is completely counterintuitive. It says things that makes no sense in our world, but yet, when we go in the lab and we do it day in and day out, the predictions are always correct. So I'm going to attempt to teach you quantum mechanics in a minute and a half. So you can go to university, take an introduction to quantum mechanics course. They're going to give you a 350-page book, and that's just the introduction to the introduction. And that by page three, you're doing triple integrals already. But this is the mathematics of quantum mechanics. It can get arbitrarily complicated, but that's to very quantitatively predict things. But ultimately, quantum mechanics is about explaining the behavior of things. And the behavior can really get boiled down into two simple rules. Simple, as long as you're willing to give up reality as you know it. So if you're willing to do that, quantum mechanics is ridiculously simple. Rule number one, we refer to it as the superposition principle. The superposition principle says that if a particle can be, for example, here or there, then quantum mechanics allows it to behave as if it was at both places at the same time. And here I'm stressing the as if. Because we don't know really if it's really at two places at once. But it doesn't matter, because at the end of the day, what matters is what you see at the end. And what you see at the end can only be explained if at some point the mathematics was taking into account that the particle was in both places at once. Now, we saw movies that talk about the multi-universe approach or the many-world approach. Those are interpretation of what it means to be at two places at once. But we're not going to talk about that today. I'm a pragmatic. Ultimately, I don't care. The only thing I care is what's going on in the lab. What's going on in the lab is what I can measure. So maybe you've heard of the Schrödinger's cat before. Schrödinger's cat was a thought experiment by Schrödinger, one of the forefathers of quantum mechanics, who wanted to show the absurdity of the superposition principle. And he came up with sort of an experiment that if you put a cat in a box, and then in the box there's a vial of cyanide, the cyanide is attached to a quantum particle, and only one of the state will knock down the vial and kill the cat. So if the quantum particle is in a state of superposition of being here and there, and only the here will kill the cat, then what's the state of the cat? Well, it's because the particle is both here and there, so the vial is both broken and not broken, so the cat is both dead and alive? That doesn't make sense. But that doesn't make sense in our world. And that's the thing with quantum mechanics. Don't try to make sense of it. It's just the way it is. And you can go in the lab and measure it. We've never done it with a cat, because we're not cruel. But we know cats don't behave quantum mechanically. They're too big. But we can do that. We do that all the time with electrons and molecules and small electronic circuit. So that's rule number one. Can be in multiple, here I use places, but it really can have multiple characteristics. Could be a particle of light going this way and that way, or that way. Could be not just two values, it could be an infinite amount of value. Could be a little magnet that points up and down. So that's rule number one. Rule number two is what I refer to as the measurement principle. Measurement principle says that rule number one works as long as you don't look. This is quantum mechanics. That's it. Everything else you may have heard about, quantum entanglement, uncertainty principle, tunneling, all comes down from this. And these two rules are always on. It's not one or the other. It's always happening. I can take my quantum particle, put it in multiple states, in a superposition of states, but once I come to measure, you will measure only one of them at random. So this is the essence of quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics has been around for 100 years now, give or take. It already gave us a lot of very useful technology that we use every day. But these technologies, what we refer to as first generation, are technologies that don't really fully harness those wacky behavior of quantum mechanics. They sort of grab what happened when you have many, many quantum particles and something a little funny happen. For example, the laser, right? Laser, I have a laser here. A laser, you cannot explain how a laser works without using quantum mechanics. So a laser is, in some sense, a quantum technology. Lasers are extremely useful. For the older people in the crowd, you might remember the CD, the DVD, the younger one, the Blu-rays. Now those are, they're disappearing. But these change the way we listen to music, and they're all based on lasers. Laser eye surgery, laser welding. And there's this other thing also we use, the internet. No lasers, no internet. Some of us here know a time where there was no internet, and it was quite a different time, all based on quantum physics. LED lights. LED lights that are starting to pop more and more, extremely efficient, extremely bright, very compact, very cheap to manufacture, based on quantum tunneling. MRI machine, magnetic resonance imaging. Those are looking, so they're looking at the little spin inside the protons in the water molecule in your body and create an image, very precise image of everything in your body. Not just bones, but ligaments, muscle, veins, revolutionize medical diagnostic. Atomic clocks, very extremely precise clocks. Why do we need precise clocks? Well, the GPS is an example. When you pull out your cell phone and play Pokemon Go, what your cell phone does is it's talking with satellites. Actually, what they're talking about is the satellite sends very, very precise time signature that was generated by very precise atomic clocks. So the more precise your clock is, the more precise is your navigation. So when you're sending rockets at the end of the galaxy, those become very useful. And also probably the most important piece of technology that we've devised in the last half century, or last century, the transistor. The transistor is what your computer uses to work. My cell phone has about 5 billion transistors. Your computers have about 10 billion. There's an estimate of 10,000 billion transistors per human being on Earth. And this works because of quantum mechanics. But again, these are first generation. They use kind of ensemble type of quantum effects. Now we're working towards the second generation that is based on quantum information. So now we're really diving in and starting to use and control the quantum effect of single system, single particle, single electron, single molecule. And we take a very an information approach to this. And what I mean by that, information is just a fancy schmancy word for saying digital, zeros and ones. Your computer use, everything on your computer is all about zeros and ones. And your software tells the processor to manipulate zeros and ones and then put something on the screen. Same thing with your cell phone. Same thing with your digital clock. So now we're marrying those two together. We don't work with bits anymore, which can be zero or one, but we work with quantum bits. Quantum bits are just zeros and ones, but that behaves according to quantum mechanics. So it behaves according to the two rules. So not only can it be zero, not only can it be one, it can be in the superposition of zeros and ones. And that turns out, by using those different rules, we can do extremely powerful things. Some example of qubits. You can use, let's use atoms. Right? Atoms has electrons around them. If you take one of those electrons, you can control whether if it's in a low energy state or in a high energy state. Low energy state, we call that zero. High energy state, we call that one. And we can manipulate where they are using light of certain frequency, and we can put that in superposition. And then we can have multiple atoms, make them talk with each other and control them individually. And then we can manipulate information in a quantum mechanical way. We can use spin, which is a quantum property of elementary particle. It's like a little magnet. But the funny thing with it is that it can only point in two directions, up or down, zero, one. And we can put that in superposition as well. So electrons, protons, nuclei of molecule are a great example of spin qubit. Photons, particle of light. Particle of light are great qubits. We can use their polarization. We can use their path. We can use the time of arrival. We can say, If the photon goes that way, it's a zero. If the photon goes that way, it's a one. And then we can manipulate that. We can actually put a photon in a superposition of this way and that way. But we can also build little circuits, electronic circuits. If you look at those three here, these are natural things. They're given in, they're found in nature. Atoms, molecule, photons, that's given here. But we can engineer electrical circuit using material like superconductors that actually shows up, that shows quantum behavior. So what do we do? What can we do with qubits? One of the things I want to focus on today is quantum computing, the famous quantum computer. If I can build a computer made of many, many qubits that I can control and make them interact and then essentially make them do what I want, we can do incredible things. And I have a little video here that shows you the difference. Not sure, that kind of explain or use an analogy to explain how quantum computers are different than classical computer.
By using quantum bits instead of bits, quantum computers can make different, more powerful calculations. Imagine walking around a building. You must move from one corner to the opposite one. But if you don't have to stick to the outside walls, you can get there faster. With quantum computers, these new moves exploit quantum phenomena. There are different paths to get to the right answer and to the wrong answers. Quantum superposition lets them investigate all the paths at the same time. Things need to be choreographed, so paths to wrong answers destructively interfere, while paths to the right answer constructively interfere. This allows quantum computers to solve problems faster.
So the key takeaway here is not just that a quantum computer is faster, is that a quantum computer is different. It uses different rules. Because the computer you have today, your fancy laptop that fits in your little bag, compared to the first computer that fit in a room this size 60 years ago, are the same computer. They use the same principle, which is binary and logic. They haven't changed. They just got a little smaller, a little quicker, but ultimately they are doing the same thing. If there were things that were impossible to do back in the days, they're still impossible to do today. Quantum computers, by using different rules, the rules of quantum mechanics, can turn impossible problems into problems that are very much possible. What kind of problem? Of course, that's all what we want to know. Well, there's different kinds of problems that we know quantum computers are much better. There's a lot of problems that we know they're not better. And there's a whole whack load of problems where we still don't know. So it's still a very open field. So some examples are kind of computer science-oriented problems, like optimization, image recognition, artificial intelligence, deep learning. These, we know some of those problems quantum computer can help out. But one of the downsides is these type of problems will need many, 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 many millions of quantum bits to solve. So yes, it will help, but it's a few years down the road. What, as a scientist, what I'm really interested about is quantum simulation. Because quantum simulation are very important, but also quantum computers with only a few hundred qubits can make a real difference. Now, of course, in your head, you might ask yourself, why do I care about quantum simulation? How can it affect my life? This is what I'm here to talk about today. First of all, let's look at this pie chart here. This pie chart would be sort of a typical usage of a supercomputer cluster. That one is one of the clusters from the Department of Energy down in the States. That shows the percentage of usage on those like massive machines. Look at this. 17% is for chemistry. What is chemistry based on? Molecules. How do molecules behave? Quantum mechanics. Material science. What are materials made of? Atoms and molecules. How do atoms and molecules behave? Quantum mechanics. Fusion energy. What is fusion energy? That's nuclear physics. What explains nuclear physics? Quantum mechanics. High energy physics and nuclear physics. So we're at more than half of the pie chart so far. And all of these things are trying to calculate quantum mechanics. So first of all, just it's a fairly weak argument, but if half of the computing power of a supercomputing cluster is used for simulating quantum mechanics, it's a fair thing to say that maybe it's an important problem, okay? So everything that has to do with chemical process, even biological process, nanotechnology, spintronics, material science, they all rely on simulating quantum mechanics. But there's a problem. And one of our mentor, Richard Feynman, put it very nicely. He said, nature isn't classical, damn it. And if you want to make a simulation of nature, you better make it quantum mechanical. And what he meant by this, because ultimately, nature is governed by the laws of quantum mechanics. And turns out our computers today are notoriously bad at simulating quantum mechanics. And I'll give you a little bit of an example. Let's say I'm trying to simulate three electrons interacting with each other. And I'm not even going to talk about their position and their momentum and their orbitals. I'm just going to talk about their spin, whether it's point up or down. Now, remember rule number one of quantum mechanics. It says that it can be in superposition of everything. So if I want to simulate the behavior of my three spin, I need to take into account all eight possible configurations of those spins. Up, 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 down, up, down, up, and so on and so forth. Which means that from a mathematical and a simulation point of view, and also what quantum mechanics tells me to do, is that I need to assign a certain number. That number actually represents, in some sense, the probability of each of those things happening. But quantum mechanics tell me I need to take care of all of those simultaneously. So in order to simulate three spin, I need to keep track of eight numbers. 2^3, okay? If I want to keep track of four spin, I need 16 number, 2^4. If I want five spin, it's 2^5. It grows exponentially fast. And exponentials grows really, really fast. Let's have some fun with numbers. 260 atoms. 260 atoms would be the largest quantum state I could store in a hard drive that would be made out of all the atoms in the universe. I push that a little bit further. Let's say I wanted to store that wave function on a hard drive using the best hard drive technology, like the most dense hard drive you can find. I will need to build a hard drive that would be 10 million times the size of the known universe. Let alone the obvious argument that where are you going to take the materials, okay? That just shows you, and now 260 atoms, is that a lot? Well, let's take into account that a small protein is made of about 15,000 atoms. Proteins, the basis of life, is made of 15,000 atoms. So we're not even remotely close to be able to simulate how proteins behave. And I'll come back to why this is important. But that sort of shows you how inadequate our classical computing scheme is at simulating nature. But on the other hand, you don't need much of an imagination to think that, well, actually, now if I'm trying to use a digital computer that uses the rules of classical physics to simulate quantum mechanics, that takes an insane amount of resource. But if I build a computer that uses the same rules that I'm trying to simulate, kind of makes sense that it should be fairly easy to do. And it turns out it is. It's proven. The theory says we can do that. So if I want, take a molecule like this. Let's say it has 1,000 atoms. Classically, I will need 2^1,000 just to write down the equation. That's a lot more than the number of atoms in the universe. But I would just need 1,000 quantum bits, roughly, to simulate that. This is an example of what I mean when I say an impossible problem turned into something very possible. So, what are quantum simulation good for? I can go on and on and on, but I'm just going to talk about a couple examples. Let's say for the environment. What is the big problem now in the environment? Is the carbon, the amount of carbon in the environment. We've passed this 400 ppm threshold, and it's very alarming. What if we could capture carbon? So nowadays we do. Like when you go to a big plant that emits a lot of CO2, there's a lot of equipment there to do carbon capture. So most of the time it's physical. They have kind of scrubs and they grab all the carbon and then they go and put them in mines and then just get rid of it. But there's another way to do that. We can use a chemical process. You could find out there something called a catalyst. A catalyst is something that sort of speed up a chemical reaction. Look at this one here. This is a really, really big molecule. But what this molecule do is that when you bring some hydrogen and some CO2, some chemical mumbo-jumbo happen, and what comes out is formic acid. So you've absorbed CO2 and created formic acid. And formic acid is very good for feeding stocks, and as well it's very good for antioxidant agent. The problem with that one that we know is very inefficient. Like it works 0.01% of the time. What if we could simulate the full chemical reaction in there so that we could design properly the exact molecule or the exact catalyst that will give me a reaction that will work up to 90% of the time? We know it can be 90% efficient. We just don't know what the molecule looked like. Because, I mean, look at this one. I mean, there's, I don't know, just by eye view, maybe 150 atoms. We cannot simulate that now. So what do we do instead? We use supercomputers and do approximations and blah, blah, blah. And what's wrong with approximation? Is they approximate, which means they're wrong. Okay? So that's an example of where a quantum computer could become handy. Designing catalysts that do exactly what we want to do, and then we could potentially capture up to 90% of the CO2 in the environment. So very good. Another example, application to medicine. So I already talked about protein. Now I'm going to talk about why it's important to study proteins. So proteins are deemed the workhorse of the living cell. They do everything. There are antibodies, there are enzymes, they do transport of energy, they do transport of other material, they're structural, they're everywhere. Our entire body runs on proteins, okay? Well, one of the funny things with proteins is they are pretty big. They're made of amino acids, typically 1,000 amino acids. Each amino acid is made of about 20 atoms. So you're talking about molecules that are tens of thousands of atoms. And those molecules, they don't just exist in a line. They actually fold on themselves. Like that's an example here of a folded protein. Okay? Here's a little video. So each little ball here is an amino acid. And that's the process of how the protein folds. So again, let me repeat. The amino acids are made of atoms. Atoms behave according to quantum rules, which means that the process of protein folding is a quantum problem. So if we want to simulate exactly how that happens, we need to be able to simulate maybe 20,000 atoms. Why do we care about protein folding? Well, this is one of the most important unsolved problems in chemistry and biochemistry. When a protein folds properly, it's great. It works, it does exactly what it's supposed to do. But when it doesn't fold properly, then it becomes toxic. And we know diseases like Alzheimer's, Huntington's disease, Parkinson's disease, we know that these are caused by misfolded protein. But we don't know how they misfold, we don't know why they misfold, and most importantly, we don't know how to misfold them, to unmisfold them and make them non-toxic anymore. Because these three are terrible diseases. They touch a lot of people, and to be completely frank, although there's a lot of research being done, we're still not even close to find a cure for that. So by using quantum simulation, we could actually understand the process of folding, understand the process of misfolding, and at the same time, we potentially could design the proper drug or the proper molecule that could go bind to those proteins to either destroy them or to fix them. So this is another important application of quantum simulation. Let me give you another one, material science. Material science is beautiful. Why are your computers so good and so small today? Material science. Your computer is made of silicone. Silicone didn't just one day appear and say, hey, I'll do a great transistor. It all came from research in material science and realized that, hey, it has property that can be useful. Now let me pick one of the material, superconductors. Superconductors are a type of material that can conduct electricity with zero loss whatsoever. So you can put an electrical current and it will carry it without ever heating, without ever doing any loss. Nowadays, when we create electricity, in the transmission of this electricity, we lose 10 to 20% of it. Also, why is there that still today, we are still using coal plant and natural gas plant? Because there are places where there's no renewable source of energy readily available. There's no possibility to have a wind power plant or a solar power plant. So you have to build something that is not necessarily good for the environment. Because if you actually try to carry electricity for thousands and thousands and thousands of kilometers, at the end, there's nothing left. Everything is lost. But if you could have superconductors, then you could create the energy, the electricity, where the energy is available, and then bring it anywhere you want at zero loss. So superconductors do exist, but they have to be extremely cold. So they have to be at least colder than 150 degrees. So, you know, like I'm from Quebec, and then we have a lot of hydroelectrical dam up in the north, but it's not that cold up there. So even though it's cold, we cannot afford to cool wires down to carry the electricity everywhere, right? Nothing says that superconductors could not exist at room temperature. But although we have some understanding of how superconductivity works, we don't fully understand it. Because superconductivity is a quantum phenomenon that happens on global scale of a material. So if you want to understand how it works, you have to be able to simulate your entire material. Tens of thousands of millions of billions of molecules, of atoms. So now we cannot. But hopefully quantum computers will allow us to simulate, for example, this one here, which is IPCO, which is a known superconductor. It will allow us to simulate it and find out why this material in particular is superconductor. And then tell us, then give us insight on how we can build materials that could be superconductor at higher and higher temperature. So this is an example of quantum materials. Quantum materials is the field of science where we're trying to engineer material with properties that don't exist in nature. And then sometimes it can lead to very interesting, both from a scientific perspective, but also from an application perspective, very interesting behavior. And I have a nice little scientific demo here that will show you one of those. So I already said that superconductivity exists at cold temperatures, so good old liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is minus 196 degrees below zero. So very cold. That's why I'm having the glove. And that little puck here, I actually have a tiny little film of IBCO, yttrium beryllium copper oxide. And this is a known superconductor. Actually, it's one of the warmest superconductors. But I need to cool it down. So let me do that for a second. And I'll be back with you in a minute. OK. So now, it's going to take a minute to cool. What I have here is a magnetic track. It's a magnet. OK? Superconductors hate magnetic field. And because of that, we can do some really interesting thing. So first of all, now it's superconducting. It's not magnetic at all. But this is, OK? But here's what happened when I put it right on top. It floats on top. It levitates. Because it hates magnetic field, by putting it close to a magnet, what it does is it sort of creates its own magnetic field to repel what the magnet does. And by repelling it, every now and again, actually, it creates a little vortices, and it hangs on to some of those magnetic field lines. So that's why it stays in place like this. I can actually take it off, put it back there, and it'll go back exactly at the same place. So that's the one cool thing, magnetic levitation. I'm going to show you another even cooler thing. So I'm going to take it like this, make it turn, and I can actually flip it like this, and it's suspending. Okay, so it's not just levitation, it's actually pinning, it's trapped there, it's really holding on to those magnetic field lines. So now, as you notice, hopefully you did, there's no wire, there's nothing connected to the electrical socket, I'm not using any electricity at all here. I imagine, I don't know, application to transportation, where you could build a magnetic track, which is fairly easy to build. You can create a train with superconducting material, and then it would levitate, and then you give it a little push, and it just keeps on going. The only thing you need to fight is friction. So you could have very highly energy efficient transportation. So of course now it's not practical because you need a whack load of liquid nitrogen. So I mean, your train ticket to go between here and Montreal will cost you like $1 million. But if we had this, one of those room temperature superconductor, no, those are kind of nice things that can happen. So this is what I wanted to talk about when it comes to quantum computing. So quantum computing is sort of the holy grail of what we're trying to achieve. It's really not only to control the quantum world, but control and make it do something for us. But one of the side benefits of the research in doing so is that we're really developing techniques to talk to and listen to atoms. It gives us the right way to manipulate them. And there's some really nice, interesting offshoot of this. Let's go back to the two rules of quantum mechanics. We've talked a lot about the superposition so far, which is essentially how quantum computers work. How about the second rule? Second rule says that if you measure it, you will collapse the superposition. This is a challenge to build a quantum computer, because when we say measuring it, we don't necessarily mean like a human measuring it or an apparatus measuring it. Measuring is essentially any act of interacting with its surrounding in an uncontrollable way. So every time we try to build small prototypes of quantum computers and it interact with its surrounding, it kills the quantumness of it, and then we lose the quantum advantage. This is a challenge for quantum computing. But we decided to make lemonade out of lemons. Let's turn that into a feature. If it's really, really sensitive to its surrounding, then it makes a very good sensor. I can use those quantum bits to sense very, very small things in their surrounding. An example of a quantum sensor, MRIs, magnetic resonance imaging. We already talked about that a little bit. Revolutionize medical diagnostic. So just a little tidbit, a little trivia. Magnetic resonance imaging. This is based on the resonance of the spin of nuclei inside your body. So it used to be called nuclear magnetic resonance imaging. But turns out, when you tell a patient that they're going to be put in the nuclear machine, they started to freak out. So they removed, it's not even a joke, that's true. They stopped calling it nuclear, so it used to be NNMR, now it's just MRI. So MRIs is used day in and day out in medicine, but the funny part, it is not even the most common use of magnetic resonance. The most common use of magnetic resonance is for this: cheese, chocolate, and wine. Why? Well, when you make very high-end cheese, you want just the right amount of rot in the cheese. Not too much, but you want enough. So it means that you want the right amount of water, and you need to make sure that the water can go down some canals. So we can use MRI to monitor that. Chocolate, you want droplets of fat. That's what dictates if the chocolate melts or not. Too much fat, it melts. Too much. Not enough, it's dry. So very high-end chocolate monitor not only the fat content, but the size of the fat droplet using magnetic resonance. And wine, just to make sure that it's not going to poison you. But these are the main uses of magnetic resonance, which is, remember, a first-generation type quantum sensor. So now what we're doing is we use magnetic resonance, but we throw in some techniques that we've developed to build prototypes of quantum computers. So not only are we using trying to measure the spins, we're, in addition to that, using some control techniques that we've developed. And turns out we can do some pretty amazing things. Example for cancer detection. Cancer out there, so liposarcomas are cancerous cells. And liposarcomas are actually fat-loving cancer cells, but not only this, they are essentially undistinguishable from fat cell under a microscope. So essentially, you could have a tumor, and the microscope cannot pick that up. They're undistinguishable. Also, a problem with liposarcomas is they love to get close to neural tissues. So when a surgeon remove a tumor, you have to make sure that they remove everything. But if they remove too much, they can actually cause neural damage. And typically, that damage would be the loss of the use of an arm, which is not quite nice. But turns out, we know that there's one difference between fat cells and liposarcomas. And it has everything to do with an acid called arachidonic acid. So if you have a cell here, both the liposarcoma and the fat cell has arachidonic acid in the cytoplasm, and it moves around, so it's mobile. But the liposarcoma, and only that one, has also a little bit of arachidonic acid in the membrane. Very tiny layer, and that one does not move. So now we need to make a distinction between just cells that has a tiny, tiny little bit of acid that is stuck versus a cell that doesn't have it. And turns out that by using quantum computing inspired techniques, researcher here at IQC and in collaboration with Sunnybrook Hospital, were able to design a quantum sensor that can give a surgeon in real time exactly the boundary of where to cut and what to leave there. So all this based on techniques that was developed for quantum computing, but apply at a different source. Other example, diamond. We all love diamond. Turns out diamonds are beautiful, compact, room temperature quantum sensors, or actually quantum computers even. Every time you see a diamond sparkle, you're witnessing quantum mechanics. The sparkling of diamond is a quantum process. So the sparkling happened in the defects of quantum mechanics. For example, the defects of diamond. Diamond is a perfect crystal of carbon. And if it was really perfect, a diamond would look like a window. It would be boring. Every now and again, some of those carbons are missing, and they're replaced by something else. And one that we really like is what we call a nitrogen vacancy center, where one of the carbon is replaced by a nitrogen, and then a carbon next to it is just not there. So you have five electrons kind of wondering where to go. They don't have anybody to play with. They don't have any atoms or nuclei to go bind with, so they're just there. And these five electrons actually behave like one that you can control very precisely using radio frequency wave, and then you can also detect using light. Couple nice things with diamond. One, we can build it. We can create artificial diamond here in our labs. So it means that we can create diamond with just the right amount of defects. Two, they're non-invasive. You can implement diamond anywhere in the human body, and the human body will never reject it. That makes it pretty nice. Two, it's optically addressable. So you can talk to it and read it using light, which is nice. It's just lasers, fancy lasers, but laser nonetheless. These are extremely sensitive magnetometer. They can sense very small magnetic field, like magnetic field of a single electron, for example. Here's a couple of things we can do with that. Early cancer detection. We know ways nowadays of using materials that are magnetic that can bind to cancerous cells. So you can actually inject the human body with some material, some liquid, that is magnetic, and it will just go where the cancer cell might be, and they'll go bind to it. So now in your body, you'll have magnetic cells that will tell you if it's cancer or not. But the problem is you need to go read those cells. If you have a tumor, that's easy. But when you have a tumor, it's already too late. You already have cancer. Right? Hopefully the tumor is small and you can take care of it. But what if you could detect cancer when only one cell went rogue, or two, or maybe 10, let's say? Well, sensors based on diamond are actually able to measure magnetic cells when there's only one of them. So you could do cancer detection when one cell go rogue. Don't have to wait for a whole tumor. Another example, drug delivery. When you take drugs, you want to make sure that it gets delivered at the right place and in the right amount. This is a membrane of a cell, okay? In the membrane of a cell, there's ions that go in and out, go through those little channels. And then once you take drugs or medicine, that medicine goes through those membranes. So you need to be able to differentiate if the drug gets delivered. So you have to be able to go measure a certain flow of molecule at the surface of a cell. And these little thing here, you know, they're nanometer size. So we can build tiny little tips here, like AFM, electron force microscopy tips, with a little diamond at the top. Force microscopy is very good at imaging the surface. But for us, imaging the surface is useless. That's not what we want. We want to know, is there anything coming in and out of the surface? And ions they create magnetic field, because ions are electrically charged. When they move, they create a magnetic field. And we have our magnetic sensor right there. So that can tell us whether the drug was delivered or not. So very nice application for medicine. And maybe a last example is probably the holy grail of quantum sensors, is being able to do molecular imaging. Nowadays, we can do molecular imaging, but we need a crystal of those molecules. So you have, if you want to image one molecule, you have to actually to copy it in a nice, perfect matrix, and then you can do X-ray diffraction or neutron diffraction. But what if you had one molecule? Can you do a three-dimensional image of a single molecule? Then when you talk about chemistry, biology, material science, I mean, there's no price of what you can do with that. Just like the MRI gave us a three-dimensional imaging of the human body and completely revolutionized medicine, a three-dimensional or an MRI machine for molecules could potentially revolutionize nanotech, biology, chemistry, and so on and so forth. So these are just a few very concrete examples of what quantum information can do. But one thing I want to stress is that quantum information is a platform to do things. Just like digital is a platform. Right? The first time we used digital was to build this really big computer, and that's the only thing we would do with digital. Nowadays, that projector is digital, that TV is digital, my watch is digital, my coffee machine is digital, my fridge is digital. Right? The digital gave us the platform to do things that we could not even imagine. Quantum information is the same thing. These are the things that we know can be done, but it's really by keep on moving and by bringing new generation of scientists that we're really going to unleash the power of what can be done. So, thank you very much.